चैप्टर 5 किंगडम्स किंग्स एंड अर्ली रिपब्लिक इलेक्शन डे शंकरन वॉक अप टू सी हिज ग्रैंड पेरेंट्स ऑल रेडी टू गो एंड वोट दे वॉन्टेड टू बी द फर्स्ट टू रीच द पोलिंग बूथ वाई शंकरन वॉन्टेड टू नो वेर दे सो एक्साइटेड समवॉट इम्पेशेंटली हिज ग्रैंड फादर एक्सप्लेन्ड वी कैन चूज आवर ओन रूलर्स टुडे हाउ सम मैन बिकम रूलर्स चूजिंग Leaders or rulers by voting is something that has become common during the last 50 years or so. How did men become rulers in the past? Some of the Rajas we read about chapter 4 were probably chosen by Jana, the people. But around 3000 years ago we find some changes taking place in the way in which Rajas were chosen. Some men now become recognized as Rajas by performing very big sacrifices. The Ashwamedha or horse sacrifice was one such ritual. A horse was led to loose to wander freely and it was guarded by Raja's men. If the horse wandered into the kingdom of other Rajas and they stopped it, they had to fight. If they allowed the horse to pass, it meant they are accepted that the Rajas who wanted to perform the sacrifice were stronger than them. The Rajas were then invited to the sacrifice, which was performed by specially trained priests who were rewarded with gifts. The Rajas who organized the sacrifice was recognized as being very powerful, and all those who came brought gifts for him. The Raja was a central figure in these rituals. He often had a special seat, a throne or a tiger skin. His charioteer, who was his companion in the battlefield, had witnessed his exploits. Chanted tales of his glory. His relatives, especially his wives and sons, had to perform a variety of minor rituals. The other Rajas were simply spectators who had to sit and watch the performance of the sacrifice. Priests performed the rituals, including the sprinkling of sacred water on the king, the ordinary people, the Vish or Vaishya, who also brought gifts. However, some people, such as those who regarded as Sudras, by the priest were excluded from many rituals. Varna. We have many books that were composed in North India, especially in the areas drained by Ganga and Yamuna. During this period, the books were often called later Vedic because they were composed after the Rig Veda, about which you learned in chapter 4. These include the Samaveda, Yajurveda, Atharva Veda, as well as those other books. These were composed by priests and described how rituals were to be performed. They also contained rules about society. There were several different groups in the society at this time. Priests and warriors, farmers, herders, traders, craft persons, laborers, fishing folks and forest people. Some priests and warriors were rich, as they were some farmers and traders. Others, including many herders, craftspersons, laborers, fishing folks, and hunters and gatherers, were poor. The priests divided people into four groups called Varnas. According to them, each Varna has a different set of functions. The first Varna was that of Brahmin. Brahmins were expected to study and teach the Vedas, perform sacrifices and receive gifts. In the second place were the rulers, also known as Kshatriyas. They were expected to fight battles and protect people. Third were the Vish or the Vaishyas. They were expected to be farmers, herders and traders. Both the Kshatriyas and the Vaishyas could perform sacrifices. Last were the Sudras, who were to serve the other three groups and could not perform any ritual. Often, women were also grouped in the Sudras. Both women and Sudras were not allowed to study the Vedas. The priests also said that these groups were decided on the basis of birth. For example, if one's father and mothers were Brahmin, one would automatically become a Brahmin, and so on. Later, they classified some people as untouchable. These included some craft person, hunters and gatherers, as well as people who helped perform burials and cremations. The priests said that contact with these groups was polluting. Many people did not accept the system of Varna laid down by the Brahmins. Some kings thought they were superior to the priest, and others felt that birth could not be the basis for deciding which Varna people belonged to. Besides, some people felt that there should be no differences among the people based on occupation. Others felt that everybody should be able to perform rituals, and the other condemned the practice of untouchability. Also, there were many areas in the subcontinent, such as Northeast, where social and economic differences were not very sharp and where the influence of the priest was limited. Janapadas. The Rajas who performed these big sacrifices were now recognized as being Rajas or Janapadas rather than Janas. The word Janapada literally means the land where the Jana set its foot and settled down. Some important Janapadas are shown on map 4, page 49. Archaeologists have excavated a number of settlements in the Janapada, such as Purana Kila in Delhi, Hastinapura near Meerut, and Atranjikhera near Itah. The last two are in Uttar Pradesh. They found that the people lived in huts and kept cattle as well as other animals. They also grew in a variety of crops: rice, wheat, barley, pulses, sugarcane, sesame, and mustard. They made earthen pots. Some of these were grey in color, others were red. One special type of pottery found at these sites is known as painted grey ware. As is obvious from the name, these grey pots had painted designs, usually simple lines and geometric patterns. Mahajanapada. About 2500 years ago, some Janapadas become more important than others and were known as Mahajanapadas. Some of these are shown on map 4. Most Janapadas had a capital city. Many of them were fortified. This means that huge walls of wood, bricks or stone were built around them. Forts were probably built because people were afraid of attacks and from other kings and needed protection. It is also likely that some rulers wanted to show how rich and powerful they were by building really large, tall and impressive walls around their cities. Also, in this way, the land and the people living inside the fortified area could be controlled more easily by the king. Building such huge walls required a great deal of planning. Thousands, if not lakhs, or bricks of stones had to be prepared. This in turn meant enormous labor, provided possibly by thousands of men and women and children, and the resources has to be found for all of this. The new Rajas now began maintaining armies. Soldiers were paid regular salaries and maintained by the king throughout the year. Some payments were probably made using punch marked coins. You will read more about these in chapter 8. Taxes. As the rulers of the Mahajanapadas were, first, build huge forts, second, maintaining big armies, they need more resources, and they needed officials to collect this. So, instead of depending on occasional gifts brought by people, as in the case of Raja of the Janapadas, they started collecting regular taxes. Taxes on crops were the most important. This was because the people were farmers. Usually the tax was fixed at 1/6 of what was produced. This was known as bhaga or share. There were taxes on craft persons as well. These could have been in the form of labor. For example, a weaver or smith may have had to work for a day every month for the king. Herders were also expected to pay taxes in the form of animals or animal produce. There were also taxes on goods that were brought and sold through trade. And hunters and gatherers also had to provide forest produce to the Raja. Changes in agriculture. There were two major changes in agriculture around this time. One was the growing use of iron plowshares. This meant that heavy clay soil could be turned over better than with a wooden plowshare, so that more grain could be produced. Second, people began transplanting paddy. This meant that instead of scattering seed on the ground from which plant would sprout, saplings were grown and then planted in the fields. This led to increased production as well as more plants survived. However, it was back-breaking work. Generally, slave men and women, dasas and dasis, and the landlords, agriculturers, laborers, kammakaras, had to do this work. A closer look, Magadha. find Magadh on map 4. Magadh became the most important Mahajanapada in about 200 years. Many rivers such as the Ganga and the Sun followed through Magadha. This was important for transport, water supplies, making the land fertile. Parts of Magadh was forested. Elephants which lived in the forest could be captured and trained for the army. Forest also provided wood for building houses, carts and chariots. Besides, there were iron ore mines in the region that could be trapped to make stone tools and weapons. Magadh had two very powerful rulers, Bimbisara and Ajatasattu, who used all possible means to conquer other Janapadas. Mahapadmananda was another important ruler. He extended his control up to the northwest part of the subcontinent. Rajagriha, that is present-day Rajgir, is in Bihar, was the capital of Magadh for several years. Later, the capital was shifted to Pataliputra, present-day Patna. More than 2,300 years ago, a ruler named Alexander, who lived in Macedonia in Europe, wanted to become a world conqueror. Of course, he didn't conquer the world, but did conquer parts of Egypt and West Asia, and came to the Indian subcontinent, reaching up to the banks of Bees. When he wanted to march further eastward, his soldiers refused. They were scared as they heard that the rulers of India had vast armies of foot soldiers, chariots, and elephants. A closer look, Vajji. While Magadh became a powerful kingdom, Vajji, with its capital at Vaishali, Bihar, was under a different form of government known as Gana or Sangha. In a Gana or Sangha, there were not one, but many rulers. Sometimes, even when thousands of men ruled together, each one was known as the Raja. These Rajas performed rituals together. They also met in assemblies and decided what had to be done now and how, through discussion and debate. For example, if they were attacked by an enemy, they met to discuss what should be done to meet the threat. However, women, Dasas and Kammakaras could not participate in these assemblies. Both the Buddha and Mahavira, about whom you will read in chapter 6, belonged to Ganas or Sanghas. Some of the most vivid descriptions of life in the Sanghas can be found in Buddhist books. This is an account of Bhajjis from Digha Nikaya, a famous Buddhist book which contains some of the speeches of Buddha. These were written down about 2300 years ago. Ajatasattu and the Bhajjis. Ajatasattu wanted to attack the Bhajjis. He sent his minister named Vasakara to the Buddha to get his advice on the matter. The Buddha asked whether the Bhajjis met frequently in full assemblies. When he heard that they did, he replied that Vajjis would continue to prosper as long as they held full and frequent public assemblies, they met and acted together, they followed established rules, they respected, supported and listened to elders. Vajji women were not held by force or captured. Chaityas or local shrines were maintained in both the towns and villages. Wise saints who followed different beliefs were respected and allowed to enter and leave the country freely. Rajas of powerful kingdoms tried to conquer the Sanghas. Nevertheless, these lasted for a very long time, till about 1500 years ago, when the last of Ganas or Sanghas were conquered by the Gupta rulers, about whom you'll read in chapter 10. Elsewhere, find Greece and Athens in your atlas. Around 2500 years ago, the people of Athens set up a form of government which was called a democracy, which lasted for about 200 years. All free men over the age of 30 were recognized as full citizens. There was an assembly that met at least 40 times a year to decide on important matters. All citizens would attend these meetings. Appointments for many positions were made through lottery. All those who wanted to be chosen gave their names, and some were selected through lottery. Citizens were expected to serve in the army and the navy. However, women were not considered citizens. Also, many foreigners who lived and worked in Athens as merchants and craftspersons did not have rights as citizens. Besides, there were several thousand slaves in Athens who worked in mines, fields, households, and workshops. They too were not treated as citizens.